Welcome everyone to our session on why Scrum from Pakistan Agile Scrum Exchange. And today we will be focusing on why we'd like to use Scrum, which is one of the methodologies. Zeshan, let's get started with small introduction and then you can jump straight into why Agile stuff.
Okay, I think we have done introduction many times in the past. So I think next time what we need to do, we might need to do just the introduction slide at the end so participants can just read, because giving introduction every time will take like a few minutes. Anyway, right, so I'm into IT industry for over 17 years, and about 10 years ago I started my journey in Agile, and then that was the decision I made, and I'm proud of that decision now. I'm working as a Scrum Master, Scrum Coach, and a Product Owner. I worked in UK, I worked in Middle East, and still working in Middle East. So I'm also trying to promote this in Pakistan with the help of Khurram as well. So my passion is to bring awareness in Pakistan on Scrum and Agile, and also to bring international trainers to Pakistan. And in that regard, we're bringing one of the certified trainers in Pakistan to deliver certified Scrum Master training in August, 11th and 12th of August. So that's all for me.
Yeah, and about myself, I have been with software development for some time, and after some thinking and like going through the stuff that I really want to do, I felt like, oh, I can, it's very fun for me to work with the people, team, and organization. So then I looked into agile coaching and facilitation trainings and some kind of transformation as well. So far, I have mostly been working in Sweden for all these agile-related work. And I'm so excited to spread this knowledge and share my experience with the audience in Pakistan to raise the awareness, because I feel like this can really help personally and professionally to grow together. Yeah. So that was a smaller introduction. Over to you, Zeshan. Why are we using Scrum?
I think this is an open session to ask about why we are using Scrum. There are some slides as well, professionally created slides, which we can go through. But if you have any specific question, you can ask. If you want to know like why Scrum is used in organizations and what are the benefits of Scrum, if you can see this very nicely presented slide on your screen. You can see this is like a high level framework in a way that it tells you like what are the events and what are these things. But in terms of why Scrum is a subset of Agile, and it has iterative, which is like sprints, defines time box activities. So mainly it's used for software development in a complex environment, but recently the ways has been changed. Now Scrum is adopted by other organizations like construction organizations, in medical and all different sort of industries it's been adopted. But initially it was started from software development in complex environments. And now I have seen people are using this to plan their weddings as well. So when we say why Scrum is there to help bring transparency, to basically deliver on time, on schedule, and on budget. So this is a basic summary of why Scrum. And if you guys have any specific questions, we can go into those questions. But the slides you are seeing on your screen now is the slide to show you the framework. I think framework we already have covered in our previous meetups. We went into details of all the events in Scrum. So specifically, why Scrum? Khurram, you want to highlight on that as well from your side? That would be great. And then we can ask questions.
Yeah, exactly. And since both Madiha and Hassan, you have been working with Scrum for a while, that is excellent. So this session is intended more toward kind of a discussion than kind of one stream of giving information all the time. So help make this session more interactive by asking all those questions that you have been wondering for a while. These slides, I just put them for a reference. These are from Henrik Niebuhr. He has been working a lot with Agile and Scrum. And I just go happen to come across this slide and I felt like, oh, this is very nice. So when it comes to planning and architecture, this is considered as some people say that, we are in Agile and we don't need to do planning. We are in Agile, we don't need to do any architecture. And on the other side, there's a lot of big upfront planning and there is a lot of big upfront architecture. But the key is to be in the middle. So you have rough adaptive plan and you have rough adaptive architecture as well. And in this green circle, that's where Scrum and other like Kanban and XP, those agile methods comes into play, because Scrum is a iterative and incremental model. Iterative in a mean that it is like 2 to 4 weeks of iterations, and incremental in a way that in every iteration or sprint, you deliver something which is shippable.
Nice.
Yeah. So
Khurram, just to ask a question. Yeah? Previously we presented very nice picture about iterative and incremental. Can you just quickly differentiate what is the difference between iterative and incremental?
Yeah, that's what I mentioned. I have to check if that slide is still there. Not this one. But think about it, perhaps this one. So let's think. This is our
incremental. Usually there is very nice Mona Lisa picture people use in their sessions.
Exactly. So we can also take it in this way, actually. I have like similar focusing on the issue. So this one, the illustration that you're seeing is a kind of what is agile or what is incremental and iterative. I think it touches the same concept, Zeshan.
Let's go for it.
Yeah, let's go through it and see what other ideas or thoughts it can help us. It's the same from Henrik. What he's trying to say here is like agile is not like you have one tire, then you have two tires, and then you have a body on it, and then you add another body, and then be happy. This is not agile. This is not incremental. It's not even iterative, actually. What we mean by that, if we want to go from point A to point B, that is our main challenge. Our main challenge is to cover that distance in a shorter time. So if we have a skateboard, then we can do something in 1 hour. But if we have those scooties, then perhaps we can reduce that time and make the journey more comfortable. Third could be that, hey, let's have a cycle, and then we can paddle around and have a comfortable seat, and we also have some kind of direction. And then the fourth is, hey, having a motorcycle and automating the engine or the driving force, and then you have more comfortable where you can put the fuel, you don't need to put a lot of effort. And then the last is the car, which is comfortable. You have the AC, you have the radio, you have all those luxuries. So think about the all from 1 to 5. They are incremental in a way that in every iteration they are delivering something which is valuable. And think about these 5 iterations as iterative model and all these deliverables as incremental. So perhaps this could be iterative and incremental explained in one way. What do you say, Zeshan and Madhya and Hassan?
Yes, I mean, that's very good explanation of that.
Yeah, definitely it makes the sense. And like, you know, why we are doing agile. It's all about, every time we are delivering something, it is usable. And it is having some value added features as well.
Okay, so I have one question over here. Okay, so let's say we are working on a software project. Okay, and in the start we have we have to develop some features, but in the start those features are going to take a while to get it to the MVP, minimal viable product. So what would be our focus on a long sprint, or we should keep it small, 15 days? Even in 15 days, we cannot get to something like a scooty which can be usable.
Okay. Khurram, you want to answer or should I answer?
Go ahead.
Okay. So your question is about how to break larger piece of work in terms of MVP. So MVP is usually minimal viable product to the client, where you have fixed budget or you have fixed timeline and you don't have room to negotiate. So, I mean, in this scenario, Scrum fits very well because, as you said, it can be from 1 week to 4 weeks. So maximum you can do is 4 weeks. So in this instance, you break down the user stories into manageable chunk of information or requirement, and then you break those down further into smaller tasks. So when we, I mean, there is a separate session we delivered on user stories where we explained what sort of user stories should we take in the sprint and what is a user story and what is a good user story. So to answer your question about requirement that one user story will not be sufficient, so we need to break a user story in a way that each item is like deliverable, shippable, and it can add some value and it has something towards the goal of the sprint. So did it answer your question?
Yeah, okay.
And one more
you have
thing.
Any further question? Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry. And one more thing to add to what Hassan asked is like you mentioned MVP. So as the name suggests, MVP, minimum viable product, is that when you have a large project upfront, the clarity is not there. And you cannot have all the requirements as mentioned here. You cannot have everything upfront because the things can definitely change and there could be new things coming up. So the idea behind MVP and idea behind the Scrum framework is that definitely go for those bigger things, but start something smaller that can help you gain some more information so you can decide with big with fresh information. So start with smaller steps and then you can explore it more just to help you understand if you are going in the right direction or not.
Well, okay. So, I mean, sprints allows you to bring transparency, which means that we make decisions based on our experience. So in one sprint, we experience something and based on that, we create more user stories sometime out of one sprint. So, and it also helps the management to understand the value and they can see things delivering fast.
Yeah, and it also reduces the risk. So think from this perspective that you are developing a very big product or features, and it will take you 6 months to get to know how this feature works. So why not break it into the smaller chunks in a way that we implement one feature and get the feedback in 1 month? So it also helps you to reduce the feedback loops. That the thing that you get to know after 6 months, you will be able to get to know after 1 month that if this is the right direction or not. This can also help you save time. This can also help you save money, and this can also help you save effort as well.
And the last thing, it's not a magic bullet. So you learn from your experience. And as you can see on this screen, right, now, those events, they have purpose, all those events. I'm sure you have familiarization to those events. Let's take an example of daily stand-up. Daily stand-up. You talk about previous day and you talk about what you're going to work today and if there is anything blocking you. So daily basis, you are inspecting into the problems. Daily basis, you are adapting. You are changing the way you are working. You are removing impediments. And then if you go through all these four key events, you will see the value and you will see how it will help you to deliver your MVP.
Yeah, great. Yes, this is good, and all these are very valid questions. Any other thoughts from Junaid or Madiha regarding why to use Scrum?
Hello.
Yes, go on. We can hear you.
Okay. I think using Scrum is good, Benny. Thank you. I think using Scrum is good for the environment when you have a big product and you have to deliver thing upfront quickly. Like I have personal experience. I worked on a product for like 2.5 years and we delivered it in the end. We have to work for like 8 months again. We were doing it in a traditional model. So when we go to the customer, we came to know that no, this is not what the customer was requiring actually. It's like we did our first demo of the product after 2.5 years, and we get to know that it's not the right thing that the customer wanted. So we get back and we had to work for like again 7-9 months. And it's better if we had done it in Scrum environment. We might have got to know in first 3 months after first release. If we do it like three months of release and we go to customer, we show it to the customer, and then he can just simply tell us right away that no, after 3 months we can set up a pace, we can decide our direction and adjust our course. That no, it's not the right direction. We have to do it like what customer wanted. So it's good to get customer feedback early. This is the main thing in it. And we provide value early. Like this is something user can actually deploy in the environment to work and actually check. Maybe a beta environment they can use with the inner environment. And it'll be easy for transition as well. Like the user, business user will get to know that, okay, this is the new system coming in. So they'll get used to with this new system early as well.
Very good explanation, Junaid. That this is first hand information from Junaid, who worked in, I think, Waterfall previously. Now you're trying to adopt, or you are already doing Agile in your organization, right, Khurram? Sorry, Junaid.
Yes. Thank you.
So I joined.
We're currently doing it in Agile as well.
Great. So I joined a bit later, so I didn't get a chance to get intro of Hassan. I think Madia and Junaid are our existing participants. So Hassan, can you just quickly give us introduction?
I'm Hassan. I have been working in IT industry for almost six years. I have also some experience in other than IT in, you can say, more kind of engineering and manufacturing. Okay. I have seen like this Scrum management can be applied to all kind of projects, as we have already discussed. It's not just about IT and anything. So we have been doing Scrum at our software house, and it's been going very well. We usually divide the sprints with 2 weeks in 2 weeks. And we update the client at the end of each sprint, like what has been done and what was supposed to be.
Oh, nice. So you're already practicing it.
Yeah. We have already been doing it and it's going good. So right now I'm looking forward to have like more hands-on Scrum professional experience and trainings and certifications, things like that.
Nice. Very good. So, I mean, what was the reason to go into Scrum?
Yeah, the same reason, because you know this right now it's a continuously evolving world, and actually we work most with startups, and when anyone comes up with an idea, he's not sure what is going to be the final product, and even if he's sure, we have to be agile enough to like change the idea on the way so that it can cater to the market needs. So let's say if I start with something, I have maybe a parking app in the mind, but along the way I see there's more need of something else. So we have to be agile enough to change it. So Scrum perfectly fits in this scenario, and we have to like, it's been a great tool and helping in all this.
Exactly. I mean, that's the reason Scrum is playing a very key role in software industry these days. And that relates to our topic as well, why Scrum? So you already have explained why we want to do Scrum because of all these benefits you are having. So that's very good explanation. So from your experience, is this something you think bringing transparency in the team and it's allowing you to complete work in the faster pace? What benefits you are seeing now?
Basically, the most beneficial part of this whole exercise is, I would say, transparency to the client. So he is,
yes, exactly.
He knows what's going to be done in this sprint and what has been done, and we can track the progress. So I think, and he, if he can test it at the end of that sprint, and if something is going to be changed, he can give his like you can say his feedback earlier on, rather than if all the product is done and we go to the client for UAT and say he would be saying, oh, I didn't need it this, it had to be done this way. So the earlier on you get the feedback and the changes are been easier to be incorporated in the project, and obviously that will lower the cost of the project and everything.
Exactly. So this is one aspect, like your client is happy and you're bringing transparency to the client. So the other reason to use Scrum is basically it also motivates the team. So team, like development team, basically, who are never exposed to the client, who are never exposed to the senior management. In Scrum, they get a chance to showcase their work in the demo session. So demo session, you bring your Scrum team, you tell them to basically demonstrate what they have done. So then they feel empowered. Then they feel like their work is being appreciated. So they are motivated. So it brings motivation in the team. So that's another aspect of using Scrum. The third part is like it brings transparency to the management as well. And the confidence of management on the team increases because they see value is being delivered incrementally. They see their team is performing. And if they are using story points, they can see the velocity is increasing. So it's win-win situation for everyone. So these are the key reasons which you mentioned, which Junaid mentioned and Madhya mentioned, are the main reason like why people use Scrum. So it's like an ecosystem. It helps everyone. It helps the client. It helps the management. It helps the team who are working on the product as well.
Yeah, and just to mention one more point, it's like it's a framework. It does not describe everything hard and fast. So all the teams do have this possibility to adopt as per their project, as per their need, or as per their company as well. So this is a good way to be flexible to support agility as well in the organization. Yeah, so I'm just wondering, like, since most of the audience has been working with Scrum for a while, what questions do you have in your mind that we can discuss it openly here?
So I have one question.
Yes, please.
Hello? Okay. So the way we populate our backlog for the user stories, can you guide me about how the way you do it at the start of project? You have some inception phase where you have a user story writing workshop in the first place. You do it with customer upfront, and then you, the product owner, like not Scrum Master, product owner goes with the team and discuss it, because the product owner is mostly from the company side and the customer, he has to interact with the business user. So you go to the customer. This is the case where the business user is not sitting directly with the development team. So the product owner is the person development team have to go to. And what do you think about that? So the user story refinement session, that will be done with the development team and the product owner. And he'll have to get back to the business user for clarification if required. If you have faced such scenario, how do you think you work with it? And what's the best possible way of doing Scrum in this?
Yeah, Junaid, your voice is breaking a lot. I don't know, it's just for me or for other people. Are you able to hear Junaid?
No, it's breaking for me as well.
Junaid,
okay, but I think
okay.
I think we got the gist of it. So the question is the early stage, how you build your backlog and how you create user story from the client feedback. Is to sum it up, this is your question, Junaid, right?
Yeah, Junaid, I have requested everyone to write your questions in the chat, so we can take it from there one by one. What do you say?
Yeah, I mean, they can write question. I mean, if one person is asking question, the other person should be able to write the question. But I mean, while if we are in the session and if everyone starts writing, then it will be very quiet. So we need to keep the momentum going. So I think Khurram is having some difficulties in the connection. So there is a question from Adia. You want to read, Khurram?
Yeah, so one reason is that otherwise we might end up in technical issues. So let's write it on the go as well and keep the discussion going as well. So Madhya is asking, my question is that if we are doing a project in Scrum and having 2 weeks sprint, can we take that project up to 1 year or 2 year overall? It totally depends on the scope of the project, actually. That's would be my opinion, that if you have a smaller project, then it could be even 6 months. And if you have a bigger project, it could be even 2 years as well. So totally depends on the number of features that you have from the customers. Yeah.
I basically, the reason of my question is that it was never in my mind, but someone on the other side of the table, it was one of the interviewers who asked this question, and he said that how it is possible that you are agile project manager and you are running one project for 1 year. So then I told them that yes, it's all right, we can do it. It depends overall, what is the length of our project or the product, how many features we want. So, but then I was puzzled, because that person's understanding was that if we are all the Scrum projects should be around 3 months, 6 months, or maximum 9 months
length. As you mentioned, the length totally depends on the content of the scope of the project.
Okay, I guess that person was.
So I think Madhya's and Junaid's questions are interrelated. So what Madhya is asking is, if you're doing 2 week sprint, then can we take the project to up to 1 year or 2 year? So you don't know how long it will take. And a question which Junaid asked is, when you are at the early stage of building your backlog, how you create the user stories with the business users, and where business users are not sitting with the team. So there is an artifact called user story mapping. I don't know if you guys have heard about this. So I know Junaid mentioned refinement session or grooming session, which are the later stages. But if you are starting a greenfield project, means you are starting from zero. These sort of activities are done in sprint zero. Sprint zero means you are gearing up, you are setting the things to get your sprints ready. Because when you are in the sprints, it's continuous development, and you need to have all your backlog items refined and groomed. So in order to answer the question to Madhya and Junaid, what I usually do is, when I'm starting a new project with the new client, I bring the client if they can come on site in our location. If they can't, I go to the client side with my development team and all the key stakeholders who are involved in the project, and ask them what they want to do. Let's take an example. If they want to build a website of clothes, so we ask them, what are your high priority features? They say, okay, our features should be, there should be a functionality for login, there should be shopping cart, there should be facility to buy online, there should be facility to choose multiple products. So this activity is done using the post-it notes. So you have one clear white background where you start sticking those post-it notes with high level features, and then you ask them, okay, so what will be sufficient for you to go live? So first you ask them what you want to do from the website. They give you all the answers. Then you ask them what is sufficient for you to go live. And then they start moving the user stories up and down. And then what you do, you draw a line in the middle and you say, okay, below this line, we are going to skip for our MVP, and above this line, you have these features. Are you still happy with this? They will rethink and they say, oh no, actually this is more important, and they will move down. So basically what it gives us it gives us the full backlog. So within like 1 hour or 2 hour activity, you create the full backlog. And with this backlog, you can also define the length of your project. So let's say on the wall, you have now high level features, and below high level feature, you have all these user stories. Now you can take one user story from the middle of the your user story mapping board, and you say, okay, I'm giving this user story, just finger in the air, 8 points, and you stick in the middle. And it's called relative sizing. So you ask the stakeholders and everyone, I have given these 8 points based on the complexity or based on the work required. So if this is 8, can you size the others? So another 2 hours, you size the full backlog. And then from that backlog, you know that you have total 200 points. And if you run your first sprint, you will get the velocity, means you can tell your management you can take, let's say, 5 user story equals to 50 points. And now you can see your full backlog, which has about 500 story points. And then you can start calculating that if in one sprint you delivered 50, then maybe in 40 sprints you can deliver 500 story points. So that way you can say, okay, this project will run up to 2 years or 1 year. So I hope this will answer Madiha and Junaid, both of your questions.
Yeah, and I also have shared this user story mapping view. So just to complement what Zeshan said, so this is how your flow looked like in the journey, user journey. And then with each page, for example, product search, for example, with product page and checkout, you have those respective stories underneath it in a kind of a column way. And then, for example, in release one, you put all those necessary user stories that can help you to make that user story like flow possible. And in the second release, you can, so now you see that in release one, two, and there, you have kind of a slice for all those features in from vertical to horizontal. Yeah.
Exactly. Very good, Khurram. Yes, that really explains the process I was trying to explain. So any question on this process, guys? I mean, Junaid and Madiha, are you clear what we are talking about?
Yes, I'm clear. Thank you so much. Yeah.
So one thing that I just realized from Junaid's question, I think he has very interesting question. I think
Junaid is breaking as well. Junaid is trying to speak, but he's breaking again.
Okay. So I hope if technical issues are always there. But I mean, my eyes, my brain is still there. He has asked a very interesting question. So is there that PO writes the user stories with business users? The business users are not sitting with development team. So that often happens in the traditional model where the business stories are describing all those requirements and they're not even sitting with the development team. And then continues in the refinement, development team asks PO, who in case not able to answer will get back to the business user. Of course, business product owner also need to understand the features. And in practical experience, there comes some trust issue because business users have and PO is from DevOps company side. This is very, I think what I have seen, this scenario often happens when the companies are moving from traditional to agile stuff. And one, because you can clearly see that they are working in the silos and there is no communication between the product team and the development team. So in this case, you definitely have the test issues, but if this also gives a an issue that PO is not empowered, because PO needs to have certain influence in the organization that he or she can take certain decisions along with input from the business and from the tech as well. So what usually is recommended that during refinement, you can always invite those business stakeholders into the refinement backlog refinement sessions. So development team has all the opportunity to talk, to ask questions directly to the stakeholders along with presence from the product owner. And we have been trying this in a way that Often when I was scheduling the backlog refinement issue, I used to see which user story needs an external person. And we used to invite that person directly into our refinement session. And once that person was done clarifying or providing information to the development team, that person could easily leave. And this way, it was very quick. Junaid, does that answer your question or give some different insights? Okay, I'm not sure if that is yes or no. Okay, so he does that. Yeah, exactly. So PO has to be empowered and he needs to have certain influence in order to do that. This is very very obvious symptom that the business and development team are working in silos and PO is not empowered. In order to reduce that, invite these business stakeholders into your backlog refinement meeting and make it more open and nice discussion. So the second question, just to continue and help Zeshan answer that, how to map this with the backlog? How to map this user stories with the user story mapping with the backlog? What do you say, Zeshan?
Okay, I just noticed Khalid joined, so Khalid might be wondering where these questions are coming from. So Khalid, if you want to write questions as well, in the chat we are asking questions. So basically the topic right now is about creating backlog, and basically we started from why Scrum and now we move into some questions where there is question about why, how we build the backlog, and we were talking about the artifact called user story mapping. So going back to Junaid's question, so the question is how to map this with the backlog. How to map what exactly, Junaid? Junaid, I got half of your question.
So he's asking how to map how to use user story when you have a backlog.
No, how to map features and user stories in the backlog, right? That's the question. Okay, so basically it's visualization. So let's try to keep it a bit simpler. So when you create user story, right? So user story have specific requirement. User story is a smaller or small piece of work or requirement, but it is linked with somehow to the main feature or the epic. So when we say epic is a bigger requirement where more than one requirement is involved, that's where we call it epic. So when we visualize our board, we visualize our board sometime through features, so we call it as a feature board. So we have features, and under each feature you have user stories. So your question is how features and user stories are mapped. So as I mentioned earlier, when you create this user story mapping activity, you start with features, like key features, like login is one feature, like shopping cart is one feature, and your notification is one feature. Email notification or mobile notification, these are features. So then on below those features you have your user stories. So that's how you link all your user stories with features or epics, or sometimes it's also called themes. So to make it easier, people create themes with different colors. Let's say the notification color is purple, so that theme is purple theme. It contains all the user stories about notification. And then there is another theme. So there are ways to simplify your backlog. So it is visually attractive. And when someone non-technical or who is not involved in your Agile or Scrum process sees the backlog, he can understand what you're talking about. So you can define your backlog by feature. You can define your backlog by themes. You can define your backlog by epics. So I hope this answers your question, Junaid.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank God. Okay, my question is, can we map it in the backlog as well? Like we can put another column there so we can see it in the backlog. Sometime we have some team on another environment, on another location, so we can communicate with them easily.
So it will be easy for them to manipulate it in the Excel file rather than on a board, a physical board picture we share with them. So do we,
yes, I mean,
in practice, do it like this, that we try to, yes?
Yes, definitely. So Khurram, just to clear, Agile is providing you the knowledge to deliver projects using methodologies like Scrum, Kanban, or all these. So if you know the rules, then you can add additional things. So making your things visible, if you have ideas, why not? If you talk to the team, so basically what we're saying is team collaboration. You collaborate with the team, you say, okay, how we can improve this process? So you don't need to go by the book like these are the four features, you need to stick to it. No, you know the rules, like there are four events, you know what is user story, you know what is backlog, what is a board. Then it's up to you as a Scrum Master, how you can make it easier for your developers or for your team. So there is no hard or black and white picture which I can show you or Khurram can show you that that's how it will look. Every team, every Scrum Master have their own ways to create backlog, own ways to create the user boards. So if you feel easy doing in the Excel file, do in Excel file. If you want to do in the tool, you can create tags. In each user story, you can have tag. The user story have a tag called login. I'm just saying login because it's easier for people to understand. So you can add tags or you can add reference. So you can make it easier. You can use any terminology, but the key idea is team is happy and team understand it well and you're progressing.
Yeah, very good point about the tooling. Actually, tools are really helpful in a way, but if it's complicating your situation, then I would suggest to start with the whiteboard first. And Junaid, I think it's possible to have a user story mapping on the whiteboard if your project is not that big. Just to start with, it could be possible to start with one feature and see. The main idea is that you get the sense of a user story mapping in a good way. And then there are definitely tools available to do that. My concern is that if you start with, like, if someone starts with the big tools, they might end up doing a lot of administrative stuff than doing the actual stuff. So at my current work, we are using as simple tools as possible, all those tools, because they require less administration as well. But the user story mapping is a huge topic. And as Zeshan mentioned, I just want to quickly highlight, you have Epic, you have stories, and then you have themes. And then you can just, the main idea behind is that in each release, you map what stories will be adding value to the customer. And then you can plan it accordingly. Just like in this picture, that even though all these user stories are under product search Epic, but they are being released incrementally. So here, once more, that incremental and iterative comes into play, because at the end of release one, you are incrementing something and also iterating in the next release and incrementing again as well. Yeah, but good questions. What other questions do we have from the rest of the audience?
Let me ask one more question if there is no other question around.
Yes, go ahead.
Hello. Okay. So how big can an Epic be? Like, I'm working on a very big product. Last time we worked on it traditionally, it took us 2.5 years to complete it. So we have like big modules, very big modules with sub-modules in them. So do we need to count the Epic as it's a bigger umbrella, or we can have it like sub-Epic as well for the smaller modules within the big module? So we call it sub-Epic, or we call it Epic as well for the smaller one that goes under the same umbrella of the bigger module?
Very, very good point. Just to take this into the context of traditional project management, you have like portfolio management, right? You might have heard this word. So portfolio management means there are different projects under one umbrella. So let's say you are working for a company called Infinity and you are building a booking system for them. under that booking system, there are little different things and different project managers are managing it. So there's a portfolio of projects. Similar to this, in Agile, top level, we are saying, is an epic. So, but under epics, you can have further epics as well. So the epic, why we are calling it epic? Because it is something which is not small enough to take in the sprint. And epic is something where you have more than one requirement. So if it's a very big and complex project, then you might have multiple epics under one big epic. And then you break those epics into user stories. So those epics can be called your features. Those epics can be called your themes. So there is a way to differentiate, like to make it easier for your stakeholder. You can call high level epic and the second level theme and the third level something else. So that's the way to break it down.
And one more thing to add. What I have seen after working with 3 or 4 companies, every company has their own way of doing a product management. Some people, even if it's one product, they have different epics. And in that epic, they are covering the different part of the product. So it could be like there is one feature A to Z, A to B, A to C. So one feature is one epic. And that's all is a kind of product. So one product, then epic, then they have user stories, and then have tasks and subtasks. What I have observed that more layers you have, more complicated it becomes. So my recommendation will be to have less layers that you can track. You can have a good traceability from top to bottom. Yeah. And otherwise, you might end up in a lot of administrative stuff. And I'm not sure how much that will help you. Yes, and any other questions?
Khurram, is it possible for you to bring our Trello board? I think Trello board will answer some of the questions the way it is constructed right now.
Yes, I can bring that up. Just give me 1 minute. Meanwhile, we can ask questions, of course.
Yes, so that answers your question, Junaid. I don't know if you are satisfied with the answer or you got further ideas from this?
I actually answered on chat. Thank you. It did answer my question.
Okay, I just want to put this into the context of actual board. So I think Khurram is trying to bring our Trello board up. So in the meantime, any further questions, guys? So is this something you are using as well, guys? Have you used user story mapping in your projects? Have you used relative sizing in your project? Have you used these kind of artifacts yet?
Yes, I have been using many of them. And even this Trello board, we were using it for our project when it was in execution phase. So this is one of the very interactive and collaborative tool overall.
Yes, it's very lightweight. It's very simple. And, recently it's been bought by Atlassian Jira. Jira is a very famous tool in Agile world.
Yeah, definitely.
And recently Atlassian bought this because of the simplicity in the tool.
Oh, okay. That's great. Because I have been using Jira as well. And even we were using Trello board in parallel because we were having different teams overall in our project. So, yes, this is one of, it has become my favorite tools as well. Like we are using it for Agile and for all other personal projects as well. That's the thing.
Nice, good to know. And we also use this for our, yes.
Yeah, I will have a different opinion. I'm not sure how good a tool can help you become Agile and follow Scrum unless and until the team is motivated. So yeah, that will be my personal comment. I have used like Jira, I have used TeamForge, I have used Trello, and in every project, people have always to say something about the tool. So that's why I focused more on communication and you following the main theme behind the Agile and Scrum, because then it becomes easy. You are using the tool, so you're not becoming a tool dependent. That's what I will have to say.
That's true, but you need some ways of, like, let's say you're using whiteboard. Whiteboard is the best thing to use, but if you have a team distributed in different locations, then these tools are very helpful because then it brings transparency to the teams across the borders.
Absolutely. And since these days I'm working with distributed teams, so I'm using tools a lot. That's what I need.
Yes. But, okay, so right, so we got our Trello board up. So Khurram, can you just close this menu on the right, please?
Do you have a menu on the right? Okay.
Yeah, in the Trello, the yeah. Okay, so if you see these colors, Junaid, just to answer your question. So there is, if you see the green, black, red, they are colors. So basically, these color relates to the epic. So Scrum event is a user story under that color epic. So this is clearly differentiating between different, you can call features, or you can call them epics, or you can call them themes. So where you have similar sort of functionalities in this view, they are grouped in a way that the events are different categories. So, and then there are different categories as well. So they are grouped in different colors. So that should give you some more clear picture how it works.
Yeah, and Trello is excellent when it comes to managing small projects. That is very helpful and very quick to use.
Question. And then we gather the like similar user studies together under one theme. So this is the idea about theme, or we find out the theme first and then we write get the user studies around it, or it's the same way around, we can do anything?
No, it's a top usually it's top to bottom approach. So first you need to realize what are the key features. Like if someone is going to build a website, they need to know what they're going to do with it. What is the goal of the website? So basically the goal brings the feature. So when you know your feature, then you can break it down further. So top-down approach is better in this way, in my view.
Okay, so we compare theme with the feature. And theme, how to relate them? Theme is like feature?
Just to comment on what Junaid is mentioning, I hope you're able to see a picture. I feel like this is a really good illustration. So as Zeshan mentioned about those product portfolio and the stories and the theme, so it's from left to right in a way that first of all you identify what are your different level of story decomposition. It's like what are the different stories that you need to implement in order for one flow to finish, and then the themes are like, okay, so this is our first theme and then this is our second theme, in a way that you are organizing the releases with user activities and other flows. Yeah,
that's very good illustration.
So you mean the idea of theme in user story is same like the idea of release theme or the sprint goal, sprint theme? My question was more regarding the product backlog, that we gather the same user stories in one theme in the product backlog. And here it's like release theme of the release, that what we will be delivering to client in this release. Bit similar, but slightly different what I'm trying to ask here.
Yeah, but it also depends. I'm just wondering that it can also depends on how your user stories are written and how they are written in a way that they help to have a kind of a release theme or a kind of a user story theme as well. Because some companies they have more of a horizontal slice there, and then they also have a vertical slice in a way that supports more the release theme, or like in a way that you know what you're gonna release, just like in this diagram. So they do have all those stories for each epic or whatever you want to call them, and then they know, okay, this story is in this horizontal slice, they're gonna release it in this way. Is that similar that you're asking, Junaid?
Yes, I got the idea of it. I got the answer about the horizontal slice and the vertical slice. This was the answer to it. Thank you.
Okay, good. But yeah, nice. We have 10 more minutes left for this session. Any more questions? What will be the, so I have one question to you guys. What question do you have in your mind about agile Scrum that you have been thinking for a while and still looking for an answer? What would that be?
Managing more than one team, like we have big project. So it will be like four teams. We are going for a new project. It will be like four teams. How to manage it? Do we need four different Scrum Masters or one Scrum Master can do it? And how to, like, Scrum of Scrums, the idea of it. We'll be having one product owner.
Yeah, it's a meetup in its own way because it's a big topic. Scrum of Scrum and scaling agile is a big topic. So yeah. We can definitely have a separate session on it. But just to answer you, it depends on the organization. If they can afford more than one Scrum Master, it is good to have dedicated Scrum Master for each team. But if the Scrum Master is very skilled and very experienced, he can manage more than one team. He can manage 3 to 4 teams easily. So it depends on the Scrum Master capability. It also depends on the company's budget and these basically. That's the answer.
Okay.
Yes, any more questions? Interesting one. Any question that is still haunting you when you were about to sleep?
I think Khalid is very quiet. He knows all the answers and he will be becoming certified Scrum Master very soon along with Madiha. So Madiha and Khalid are already registered for the event.
So we have a question from Khalid. Is there anything that you want to add, Madhya?
No, it's all right. I'm just looking forward for CSM. That's the thing.
Good luck for that. I hope it's really good. So we have a question from Khalid. Why should I hire a Scrum Master? Okay, that's I think it's a kind of a very basic question. Perhaps I can help start. And then
It will go back to the topic as well. Like why Scrum? If you answer why Scrum, then you can answer why Scrum Master.
Yeah, exactly. So, but the thing is, like, it all depends on what exactly your organization or company or even team wants to do. If the organization is looking for someone who can help them get to know more about Agile or Scrum or other methodologies, then I feel like Scrum Master is a kind of a role which is a kind of engine box and can also act as an engine in a way that it helps your development team to understand what Agile is. It works with one-on-one to help individuals with the mindset, and the Scrum Master works with the team to focus on continuous improvement, and Scrum Master works with organization to help them understand what is the learning and collaborative environment. So hiring a Scrum Master can help you a lot in a way to attain the organizational agility, develop agile mindset, continuous improving team, and collaborative organization. So this follow-up is there. Agile has more than 10 methodologies. When and why Scrum? So when to use that, it's totally up to the organization and their needs. Yeah. Zeshan, do you want to add something?
Yes, all these methodologies within Agile framework, they have their own benefits, and they are invented or they were created based on criteria. Let's say if you take Scrum is time box activity. You have specific time box sprints. Kanban is continuous. You don't have time box activities. It's continuous development and release. Extreme programming is a totally different concept. So all of these have different benefits, and based on organizational need, you can adopt those. Like, for example, if you're running online shopping business, then Kanban more suited for you because you are in competitive market, you're competing with other retailers, and you need to make sure your product is up to date. You need to have a continuous release. You need to build, deliver. You cannot wait for 2 weeks or 3 weeks sprint. So you need to use Kanban. But if you are working in a software development house where you have fixed budget, fixed time, then maybe Scrum is better for you. So yes, these are the possible answers I have.
Yeah, and Kanban also focuses on flow efficiency. So if you're using the Kanban method, then it can also help you to understand how you can focus more on the flow efficiency in a way that it moves from to do to done, and then you don't have any fixed time boxing as well.
Exactly. It's more about pull rather than push.
Yeah.
So in traditional project management, you push the work to the development team. But in Kanban, you have your products backlog ready, you say pull. It's a pull. And it also, you need to define, like, each column has its own criteria. You can define how many people can work in one line. So there is a huge topic in itself on Kanban. I think we should have one topic or one meetup on Kanban because we haven't touched this so far.
Yeah, that could be an excellent idea. And what I have seen is that many people think that Kanban is super easy to do. But when you start doing it, you feel like, oh no, it looks simple, but it takes a lot of effort. And yeah, it will be very interesting to know how Kanban is used by different organizations from your experience as well. And I hope that answers your question, Khalid. Why to hire a Scrum Master and which methodologies to use, when and why? Great, nice. So we have 3 more minutes. Perhaps we can take one
can,
last
can,
question.
Perhaps can we do, in 3 minutes, can we do a quick retrospective for our new joiners as well? So we have now 6 participants there. So can I ask each of you, what is the takeaway or what is the benefit of this session and how we can improve this session and what else and any issues you have seen? A quick retrospective in 3 minutes.
Well, I had some technical issues. That is, I guess, on my part. So okay. I'll try to improve my internet connectivity next time.
Okay, great. Good. So this is one of the action for our retrospective. Junaid, you have done. Okay, Hassan.
Yeah, it's been a good session and nice meeting you all the people. And it's been a good
session. Okay, what is the action plan for your future sessions?
Well, the action plan is to have more learning about myself,
to have your questions ready, and
so
we can answer, right?
Yeah,
okay, sure. Great. And to make sure you have time available and you also share your knowledge with your colleagues, and we have like a continuous knowledge sharing community, like PASE. Khalid, your turn.
Thank you, Zeshan. It's always been a good year to meet you guys, and actually it always gave me knowledge for something new. Although I joined a bit late, but it was good. When I joined, I got something, many things new. Thank you so much.
Great. So any improvement we can make? No? Okay. Madhya?
Voice is breaking up. I cannot hear you guys. If there is a question for me, I'm really sorry.
No question. Thank you very much. So, Madhya, over to you.
Yeah, she has mentioned.
Thank you. Yeah. I even wrote the message, but now I cannot talk as well. So, thank you, Khurram and Zeshan. And basically, yes, my key take is all about, like, you know, the projects can be of any length and duration, even if it is agile. And we are following the Scrum methodology and the framework in that.
So, nice. Very good.
Yeah, that's all. So, and you guys are doing a good job.
Well, we are trying to build a community. And I think so far it's going great. Because we started from one person, now I think we are nearly 1,000 people in our meetup. And this first Certified Scrum session, we have 32 registrations and all like 20, 25 people already paid. So it will be a very good session. Trainer will be very happy with this, because initially he was not sure if people will come to the session. I was talking to him yesterday. He was very positive, very motivated. He is looking forward to that. It will be a good session for us, and I think it will open the doors in the future, because those certified Scrum Master will go back to their organizations. They will train more people, and then it will be like a continuous loop. So that's very good and very encouraging.
Yeah, that's very good.
Also, we are bringing few more speakers. There will be few more guys joining around the globe. You will see some different topics like safe, scalable agile as well, extreme programming, and then there will be a session on, I think, testing in agile as well.
Yeah, and we also have a roadmap planning session that Junaid will be helping to share that knowledge. That will be happening at the end of August. Yeah. Just to mention one more takeaway from my side as well, that there are many different ways to do everything, but always remember why you want to do it, and first of all assess your needs first from the project and organization, and then understand which framework can help you. It is also possible that things that you need is Kanban, not Scrum. It is also possible that you don't need any of them. You might need something else. It is also possible that you don't need Agile at all. So this is very important that I have seen, that always understand what exactly you're trying to solve, and then try to experiment with it in a smaller way. Yeah, that's my takeaway.
Very good point, Khurram. So this is a key point, because most of the guys, like, because I'm dealing with lots of people in Pakistan these days, I had lots of queries where guys were saying, okay, if I do this certification, my job will be granted. I said, no, I cannot guarantee your job. So don't do certification or don't do things just for the sake of doing if you don't see any benefit out of it.
Yeah, and when it comes to certification, that was always something that I faced. I had no certifications since in 2015. But the main thing is, like, having certification is good in a way that you get the knowledge in a structured way. So think about it as kind of, it gives you kind of a direction or a kind of a roadmap. Because in each certification that you do, they always have learning objectives. And go through that. You can also go through Scrum Alliance or any website and check their learning objectives. What learning objectives will you gain after taking these certifications? And that can be a kind of a roadmap for you, because CSM certification can help you to understand what is Agile, why do you need it, what are the different principles, what does the manifesto say. Scrum, in a way, that is a framework, it's much more than the framework itself. You need to learn a lot of different facilitation, coaching, training, skills. And you'll always learn new things, yeah. And not to take more than that, yeah. That's from my side. Yeah, so shall we end the session then?
Yes, okay. Let's conclude the session.
Okay, so thank you very much, everyone, for taking the time out to attend this session. I hope, we hope, Zeshan and I hope that it has been helpful for you. If you come up with any other topic that you want to know more about, for example, Kanban was one of them, we will definitely can have a session on that. And please help us by spreading the word about PASSE. And if you have any questions, you can add us on LinkedIn and we can continue the discussion there as well. Besides that,
yes. Yeah, I mean, I was just going to say thank you very much for your time. I know it's very difficult to take time out of your busy routines, but it shows that you guys are eager to learn and you guys are eager to share your experiences as well. So we need people like you. Thank you very much and keep spreading the word.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.